In this service tonight, Lord, I just thank and praise you for that, Lord. What a privileged people we are, Lord Jesus, to be able to freely be in your house and freely worship you in spirit and truth. And what a wonderful privilege it is, Lord, to be able to feel your presence and hear from heaven tonight. Lord, let us never take that for granted. Lord, as we enter into your word now, Lord, I pray that one more time you'll touch your servant. Lord, I pray that you'll hide me behind the cross of Calvary, and the words that I would speak tonight would be what thus saith the Lord. I pray, Lord God, that you'll flow through me and use me and allow me to be your mouthpiece and your hand extended. Lord, touch the hearts of your people tonight. Have your will. Continue to have your will in your way in this service. And Lord, I'll fail not to give you the glory and the honor and the praise, for I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. I'd like to speak to you for a little while tonight on the subject, our home security system against the thief. Our home security system against the thief. John chapter 10 and verse 10 says this: the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that you might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. Now I'm here to tell you tonight, and you already know this, that we are living in a great time of trouble. Our country is in a lot of trouble. The Bible tells us in Luke chapter 21, the fact that in the latter times that men's hearts will fail them because of fear of the things that have come on the earth. And I see that happening today. And I want to say tonight, if we don't have Jesus Christ living in our heart, then we best be afraid, because there's much to be fearful about. You know, we can't turn on the news without hearing all the bad things that are happening. You know, it's like we're sitting on a time bomb. We hear about North Korea and all their threats to America. We know that Iran would rather see our heads chopped off. We realize that we have many enemies all around the world. But yet America continues to turn their back on their only help, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. We have taken the prayer out of the schools. We've taken the Ten Commandments down from every place that we can possibly take them down from. We've taken away the manger scenes and every single thing that has to do with God in our country. What hasn't already been taken away, they're going to soon fight to take the rest of it away. And you, let me tell you tonight, they won't be happy until "In God We Trust" is taken from our currency, because they want God kicked out of every single thing in this country. We now live in a country where the instruments that God gave the doctors wisdom to use to save lives are now killing babies at the tone of 3,000 to 4,000 a day. It is now, in this country, if you do something to a bald eagle, you're going to jail. But yet you can wait until a live baby is ready to be born and suck its brains out and tear it to pieces, and you're okay. I'm telling you, church, that's sick. There is something wrong. In this country, you are more protected if you are a dog or a cat than if you are an unborn baby. This country is in trouble. This country is divided. We were born a Christian nation, but I'm here to tell you tonight that America is now a post-Christian nation, and we've done everything we can to stamp God out of everything that has to do with this country, and we will pay the price. Our streets have become war zones. When I was working the other night, I think it was Thursday night, my client was watching the news, and I heard about this 17-year-old girl that was just driving down the street and got caught in the crossfire of guns. It's becoming a normal thing in our country, because we thought we knew it all. We thought we could take God out of our country and still be okay. But I'm telling you tonight, there is a price to pay. And America is not going to experience the judgment. America has already started to see the judgment of God. Is it any wonder why our country is in trouble? Are we living the abundant life that Jesus told us in the scripture that I just read that we could live? I dare to disagree with you tonight if your answer is yes, because I barely see an abundant life. But that's the world. That's the world system. But what about the church? Do I see people in God's house living that abundant life? You know, God has blessed America so much. We have so many churches. You can practically find a church on every street corner in America. The churches have wonderful sound systems, carpeted floors, heat in the wintertime, no old potbelly stoves to fire up the coal or the wood, air conditioning in the summertime, padded pews to sit on for comfort. God has blessed us. But sad to say tonight that a lot of churches are vacant except for maybe on a Sunday morning. And even sadder yet to say, the ones that aren't vacant, many of them are vacant of the main ingredient, and that is the power of the Holy Ghost. Churches are in trouble. It's not just the world. And repentance has to begin at the house of God. Amen. You might say that's harsh, but I'm telling you tonight, that's not harsh. That's truth. And I am one that I do not believe that someone should stay in a church that's dead just because their great, 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 great grandfather on their wife's side or mother's side was a deacon. I see that a lot. People say, well, God's not moving in our church, but I've been there a long time, so I'm just going to stick it out. Let me tell you something. If the ship's going down, it's time to bail out. We are living in too late of an hour to be playing around. Get out. It's too late of an hour. I know good churches, lively churches, and churches that are alive in God are hard to find, but it's not impossible. We have one here, amen? We talk so much of old timers being so strict. And I don't have time to tell you tonight, just in the years that I've been in Pentecost, how things have changed. But I will tell you this, it's a whole different ballgame than what it was when I first got saved and filled with the Holy Ghost. We've gone a long way, and trust me, most of it wasn't the right way. We talked about people having rules and laws and things like that. And yes, maybe some of them were a little strict. But I'll tell you one thing, those people had something. They had dedication. I'm telling you tonight, we don't see dedication anymore. If we held a position in a church and we weren't there when the doors was open, unless we were sick or working or had a pretty good excuse, we weren't allowed to fill that position in that church. That's just the way it was. We had to be the example to other people that we were called to be. Whether we disagree with that or whether we don't, I'm just here to tell you tonight that we better be starting back to the old paths. They had dedication. They had a power with God. I've told you before, when I was a young person, I was afraid to do anything during the week, because I'll tell you what, when I got there for youth on a Wednesday night, if I did anything during the week, God would reveal it to the youth leader and she would have no problem telling me about it. That's what we need. We need those old-time paths. We need people that are filled with the Holy Ghost and flowing in the gifts of the Spirit. That's what my children need. That's what my grandchildren need. But they were dedicated. They were full of the power of God, and they had a testimony. We have allowed the thief that I just talked about in this scripture to steal so much from us until we've gotten to the point that it's hard to tell the church from the world. We will never, ever, ever. win the alcoholic by sitting beside him in the bar. We will never, ever, ever pull the people out of the world if we're standing right there and doing the same things they're doing. There has to be a difference. It is black or it is white. Nowadays, there's no such thing. It's all gray, and that is not pleasing to God. It's either black or it is white. We have tried to replace the Holy Ghost. We have tried to do the Holy Ghost's work with our three-step programs, with our seminars on how to grow a church, with bringing in the entertainment from the world to try to win our young people and make it appeasing to the people. We've replaced altars with counseling rooms. We've even got churches now that try to teach you to speak in tongues. I'm here to tell you tonight, nobody had to teach me to speak in tongues. When the Holy Ghost came on me, my tongue felt like it was about 2 feet long, and I'm telling you what, I just let her fly. Nobody had to be touching me and telling me what to do or taking me off to some room to try to teach me how to do it. It was a super and is a supernatural power. We will never win people, church, by bringing in the world's way and bringing in their entertainment. What we need is a good old dose of the Holy Ghost, and we need to learn to wait upon him until he comes, until he shows up. If we come here every single service, every single night of the week, and the presence of God is not here, we may as well sit at home and watch TV. Churches are full of people who need a touch. They're full of people who need deliverance. They're full of people that need a supernatural touch from God. The divorce rate alone in the church is just about the same as it is in the world. That ought not to be. We are in trouble, and we have to turn it around and get back to the old path. We have allowed the devil to steal so much for us, church. This is not the abundant life that Jesus promised us. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5. And I'm going to start at the 21st verse. Mark chapter 5, beginning with verse 21. And when Jesus was passed over again by ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And beheld, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet, and besought him greatly, saying, My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had and was nothing, better, but rather grew worse. When she had heard Jesus, came into in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, If I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, Who touched my clothes? And his disciples said unto him, Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, Who touched me? And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing that was done, what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, Daughter, thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. But listen to this. While he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogues, how certain which said, Thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, Be not afraid, only believe. And he suffered no man to follow him, save Peter and James and John, the brother of James. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult, and them that wept and wailed greatly. And when he was come in, he saith unto them, Why make ye this ado and weep? The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. And they laughed him to scorn. But when he had put them all out, he taketh the father and the mother of the damsel, and them that were with him, and entered in where the damsel was, entered in where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel by the hand and said unto her, Talitha kumi, which is being interpreted, Damsel, I say unto thee, arise. And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was of the age of 12 years. And they were astonished with a great astonishment. The thief comes to steal from us. And in this scripture, I want to go over just 3 points tonight of what I believe the devil is really trying to steal from us tonight. In this scripture, we see this ruler of the synagogue. He had an important position. And the Bible says that he came and fell at the feet of Jesus. That shows me how desperate this ruler really was. There's nothing that'll make us more desperate than one of our children being sick. And he was desperate. He had no other solution. And I want to tell you tonight, everything may be okay right now in your life. But I guarantee you, if you live long enough, there will come a time when you become a desperate person. There will be a desperate situation in your life to the point that you just don't have the answer for what to do about it. There's going to come a time in your life when you just don't have an answer. There's going to come a time in your life when the doctors say there's nothing more that we can do. There may come a time in your life when no banker can help you. There's been times in my life where I have faced desperate situations to the point that only a miracle would do. So I believe what the devil is trying to steal from the saints of God right now in this latter days is our desperation for the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no desperation anymore. And I want to tell you tonight, if Jesus is just one of your options, then he's no option at all. If you can take Jesus or leave him, then you just may as well leave him. Because he is a jealous God, and he wants all of us. I'll tell you what, I love my husband, and he loves me. But I'll tell you what, he best only be having eyes for me. Because I can become a jealous wife. And that's how God is with his people. He is a jealous God, the Bible tells us. But the devil has come to steal us of our desperation for him. There is a time and a place when only a miracle will do. And Jairus had reached this place that only a miracle would do in his life. What is our defense? What is our home security system against the devil, the thief, stealing our desperation for God? What will stop that from happening? He comes to steal our desperation. But make sure your home security system is on by A, seeking his face. We have reached a time in our lives that just a little now I lay me down to sleep is just not going to cut it. It is a time that we have to get down and begin to seek his face. B, to keep the thief from stealing our desperation for the Lord Jesus Christ. We have got to learn to sit at his feet. And just recently, I preached a sermon in this church on sitting at his feet. We have got to learn to take time from our busy schedules and all the other things we have to do and learn to take time to sit at his feet. That is why the Lord Jesus Christ said to Martha, Mary has chosen the thing that's important when she was sitting at his feet. It is important, church. We cannot bypass that fact. I need to sit at Jesus' feet, and I need to learn from his word, and I need to talk to him, and I need to remember that prayer is just more than me talking to God. It's waiting there for him to respond to me for what I'm praying about. So I am the home of the Holy Spirit of God. My temple, my body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. I am responsible for not allowing the thief that come to steal from me. I am responsible for not allowing him to rob me of my desperation for God. You see, my husband's not responsible for my relationship with God. He can help me. He can be an encouragement to me when I need it. But when it comes down to it, I'm going to face Jesus all by myself. I can't go on my husband's coattail or anybody else's coattail, nor the pastors or the deacons or anybody else. It is going to be a personal thing when we bow before him. So our home security system, we must seek his face, we must sit at his feet, and communicate with him through prayer and reading his word. C, we must praise and worship him always. Just like the Lord told us in the interpretation tonight, there's a reason why he wants us to praise him. Don't worry, just like the pastor said tonight, if we don't, no problem, he'll just have the rocks to cry out. But it's for my benefit that I worship and praise God. Worshiping and praising him brings me closer to him. It keeps my heart from being calloused. It allows me to show respect and reverence to the one that I need to respect and the one that I do need to reverence. So do not allow the thief to steal your desperation for Jesus Christ. Second point. Here was Jairus, desperate situation. No other answer. All the money he had couldn't have bought life to his daughter. The position, his job, anything he had, I'm sure he would have given anything he had to see his daughter live. But there was no solution. The only solution was Jesus Christ, and that's what made him become desperate. And when Jesus started on his way to his house, I want you to picture this in your mind. When Jesus was so desperate, or when this man, Jairus, was so desperate and came to Jesus for help, on his knees, fell down, Jesus was on his way to his house with Peter, James, and John, the inner circle of disciples. I'm sure his faith began to rise because he realized that help was on the way. And he realized the only hope left that he had was on his way to help. His faith must have just skyrocketed. But on the way to that house to where his daughter lay dying, there was someone else with a need. And she came. She was desperate too. God loves desperate people. I say, God, make me desperate. And on his way there, while he was on the way to help, here came another desperate woman pushing her way through the crowd. She realized also that that was her only solution. She already spent everything she had on doctors to no avail. And the crowd was great. Didn't matter. She was desperate. So So she pushed through the crowd until she just reached down and was able to touch the very hem of his garment. Desperation. And when she touched the hem of his garment, the Bible says immediately Jesus felt that virtue flow from his body and she was made every bit whole. What an exciting time for her. Everything was good. Two desperate people, Jesus helping both of them. Then something happened. This man's faith was high and lifted up on his way to the solution for his daughter. But meantime, here comes people from his household coming to him, and they say, "Don't bother the master. It's too late. Your daughter's dead." What do you think that tried to do to his faith? Has Satan tried to speak to you lately? Has he tried to tell you, "You may as well forget it. It's too late. This situation's dead. Your son, your daughter's never going to come to God. You're never going to be healed. This isn't going to work out for you. You just may as well hang it up." What a final word. What this word brought. But Jesus always has the answer. What did he say? "Fear not. Only believe." I totally believe tonight, church, that the devil is out to destroy our faith. We have a faith crisis in the church today. I'm not just talking about this church. I'm talking about the church as a whole. People don't believe God anymore. It's too easy to believe in the local food bank or the banker or a friend or something else than it is to believe in God. No one wants to believe in God for the impossible anymore. But God is a miracle-working God. And I believe in these last days, even more so as we see the day approach, that the children of God best start believing in God more. Because there's going to come a time with the way things are that we can't put our faith in doctors anymore. Or even in the economy anymore. And God forbid you try to put your faith in the government. So there is coming a time, not far off, that we are going to need all the faith that we can possibly have. So I think of Abraham. Listen to the words in Romans chapter 4, verses 18 through 21. "Who against hope believed in hope," talking about Abraham, "that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, 'So shall thy seed be.' And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God." And I love this. "And being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform." Amen? The devil, the thief of your soul, is out to steal your faith. Abraham, the Bible says he did not ask questions. He didn't say, he didn't reason with God. He didn't say, "You must have this wrong." He didn't remind God of how old Sarah was. He didn't remind him of his age and tell him that it was impossible. He did not focus on the impossible. He only focused on what God told him. Amen. I think about Joshua. I think about God telling him, giving him the instructions for the walls of Jericho to come falling down. And he said to him, "It's all going to end in a shout, and those walls are going to come tumbling down." I can see it today. What do you mean a shout? What else? You gonna send something else in there, break them walls down? Sure, I'll shout, but what else is it gonna take? Joshua never questioned. He fully obeyed what God told him to do, to the very instructions that he told him to do. And when the shout came forth, the walls came tumbling down. I'm reminded of Noah. When God told him to go build the ark. Can you imagine? Go build an ark. Gave him the instructions. Can you imagine the questions in his human mind? Can you imagine him saying, rain? What's rain? And how am I going to get all them animals into that ark? Well, God, do you have in mind, can you keep in mind what that's going to smell like in there? If that had been me, I'd have had a real problem because I get sick even when I go in the barn. But he never asked those questions. He didn't say, but God, is there going to be plenty of Mountain Dew there or plenty of potatoes out there? Or is there going to be enough stuff for me to eat, or am I going to have to fast most of the time? These are the things that our human mind would wonder. But not Noah. He heard God, he knew he heard God, and he stood on what God told him to do. Give us more people like that today. Amen. I think about Moses. And it's so wonderful that God gave us these people in his word that we can read about and kind of try to put ourselves into their situations. And it's funny sometimes to think, Lord, how would I have reacted to that? And I realize every single time that I would have fallen a whole lot shorter. But there was Moses. First, he tried to make an excuse and say, well, you know I have slow speech. I can't talk right. Why are you calling me to do that? But God knows what he's doing. And he called them. And here they were, and they were facing the Red Sea. And they came, and the waters were there. The Red Sea was there, and the Egyptians behind them. And God simply instructed him to hold his hand and staff out over that water, and he parted the Red Sea. Can you imagine if that was one of us? I would say, God, you see how deep that water is. This is just a human hand here, God. I must not be hearing you right because I don't know what that's going to do. Sticking my hand and staff over the water. But these men of faith had faith enough to believe what God told them. And the Bible says that he parted the Red Sea. The thief is out to steal your faith tonight. You know, I brought this little illustration tonight because it reminded me when God was giving me this sermon. I remember my days of high school. I still dread them. Remember I told you before, people would say, oh, you wish you were back here. Well, I'm here to tell you I'm blah, blah, blah years old. And I have never once wanted to be back in high school. It was some of the worst times of my life. And I'll tell you, nothing wrong with education. And I thank God that my doctors went to school a long time after high school. I thank God they do, and I hope they didn't cheat their way through. But I thank God that they did, but it certainly wasn't for me. I couldn't wait to get out of that high school. I certainly didn't want to go back into it. But anyway, one of my high school years, I took an art class. Now, you have to understand, I can't draw a thing. I am probably the worst drawer in the whole United States. I love to color. I still color sometimes. Sometimes my husband will get me a coloring book for Christmas. But I can't draw a thing, and I'm not an artist. But I took this class for two reasons. One, it was a credit, an easy credit, I thought. And two, there was a real nice-looking boy that was in that art class. And I thought he kind of had a crush on me, and I thought, this is going to be even easier than what I thought. So knowing I couldn't draw, knowing I didn't know a thing about art class,
Into that classroom I went. I made sure I had a nice dress on because back then the girls wore dresses. And I made sure, and I think he was making sure too, that we had those round tables and he sat right beside me. Boy, I thought, man, I knew what I was doing by taking this art class. It's going to be easy and it's going to be another credit. Well, I want to tell you something. I faked my whole way through that art class and he helped me. But anyway, this one day, our art teacher, I'll never forget if lived to be 100, he gave us a simple bar of soap. And he gave us this old chiseling tool. And he said, what I want you to do is I want you to take this bar of soap and I want you to make something out of it. I want you to chisel something out of it. You can make anything out of this bar of soap you want to make out of it. It's your choice. And I'm there thinking, man, I can't draw anything. In fact, here's a little heart I tried to make out of soap. Now, this will show you two things. I wasn't lying about no talent for drawing, and I didn't marry the artist that sat beside me in the art class. But anyway, he gave us the soap. And man, that nice-looking boy beside me was just drawing and starting to chisel, and I bumped him on the arm, and I said, you know I can't draw anything. He said, oh, you can do this. It's a simple thing. I said, no, I can't. Will you draw me something on this soap? Will you help me? And when the teacher turned his head, he grabbed my bar of soap and sketched a car, a race car, right on that bar of soap. And I thought, well, I wouldn't have chosen a race car, but beggars can't be choosy. So I started chiseling away at the soap. I'll tell you one thing. That teacher would have had to been crazy if he thought I really chiseled that out of that soap. I'm sure he realized what was going on. But I said all that to say this. When we think of faith, we have to realize this. Sometimes we look at Jesus Christ as being the potter and him needing clay to make something. But Jesus can make something from nothing. He is not only, would only be the master potter, but he is also my creator that didn't need one single thing to speak the whole universe into existence. That's the kind of God I serve. And tonight, the devil is out to rob you of your faith that you have in Jesus Christ. What does the Bible tell us about faith? It's impossible to please God. Anyway, I'll take my little heart back home and throw it in the trash. Half of a heart. But what is our home security system from allowing that to happen to us? How can we stop the devil from stealing our faith? Number one. We have to realize tonight, I learned a little song in Sunday school a long time ago. Every promise in the book is mine. Every chapter, every verse, and every line. Any of you ever hear that? It's true. God's word is full of all kinds of promises. And all we have to do is claim those promises. My home security system from causing the thief not to steal my faith is I will not focus on the problem, but I will focus on the problem solver. Amen? He is bigger than any problem that I could possibly even begin to face. And better than that, he knows the problem's coming before it even gets here, and he already has a solution. Amen. Two. The simple words that he told Jairus. Be not afraid, just believe. And number three, rest. You know, saints of God are full of worry today. But I believe when we have followed these steps that I'm giving you tonight, and we have not allowed
the thief to destroy our relationship with God and our desperation for him. And we are sitting at his feet and we are seeking his face. And we are stopping the fiery darts of the devil. We can have that peace that passeth all understanding. And we can have a rest in him that no one or no thing can ever take away from us. No matter what the doctor tells us, no matter what my bank account looks like, no matter what my eyes see, no matter what my eyes hear, if I have enough faith in Jesus Christ, the Bible tells me if I have the faith of the size of a mustard seed, I can speak to that mountain and see it being removed. Amen. Our home security system to stop the thief or the devil from stealing our faith is not focusing on the problem, but on the problem solver. It is not being afraid, but just believing. And it is resting in his love. And shoot, you know why I can rest in God's love? Because it's like an old Negro hymn, "Ain't nobody do me like Jesus." And that's the way it is. No one loves me like Jesus does. No one knows me like Jesus does. He's a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. And I can rest in him because I know what the Bible says. What does it say? All things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. That did not say everything is good. Sometimes we get that a little bit mixed up. Bad things are going to happen. It rains on the just and on the unjust. And there's things in this life that I may never understand. Godly people go through tough situations and hard times. But I can promise you this. I don't have to understand because I know in the whole big puzzle of life that all things are working together to bring good. And I tell people all the time, if something is bringing you closer to God, it is not your enemy. And God will take the worst of situations and he will turn them around and he will somehow bring good out of them. And the next time you have to face that and the devil says, "Oh, look what's happening to you," you'll stand and you'll say, "Devil, I've been already down this road, and the same God that brought me through the last time is going to bring me through this time." And your faith is going to begin to increase, and your home security system's going to kick in, and you're going to believe, "Oh, no, devil, I'm resting in him because he's going to take care of me, and he's going to see me through to the end." Amen? So do not allow that old thief to rob you of your faith. The third thing. The devil comes to steal from us that I want to talk about tonight. Comes to steal many things. But the Lord impressed on me three things. The last thing that he comes to steal from us that I want to talk about tonight is he comes to steal our joy and our excitement. I'm telling you what, I have never seen a day and age where Christians look so much like they're in the Molly Grubs all the time. I'm here to tell you tonight, read the back of the book. We win. Hallelujah. And I want to tell you something. The richest person in this country would trade everything he had if he would only see my mansion. But you know what? It's not going to cost me a cent. No heating bills, no electric bills, no water bill, no sewer bill, no nothing, because God's going to take care of everything. And forever and ever and ever and ever, I'm going to be with him sitting around the throne shouting hallelujah and spending eternity with my family. But he's out to steal us of our joy and our excitement for God. Why do you think the Bible tells us the joy of the Lord is my strength? It is. The Lord sent us the Comforter, the Holy Ghost. There's 12 different ministries of the Holy Ghost, and we don't have time to go into all them tonight. He's a comforter. He convicts and leads people to the Lord. He leads us into all truth. But the thing I want to concentrate on tonight is he gives us a little taste of heaven right here on earth. Amen?
I thank God that I'm Pentecostal tonight. I'll tell you what, I was Methodist a lot of years, but when I got a good old dose of what Pentecost was, I would never go back. And I'm not down in any Methodists. We got some good old Methodists, but I'll tell you what, I wouldn't take their place. Amen? Do not allow the devil, the thief, to steal your joy. Oh, the thief will tell you all kinds of things. Well, you don't have to be that fanatical. Don't you realize when you act like that, you look really stupid? You can be saved and you don't have to act like that. I want to tell you something. There can be a fire in a building and I don't have to jump out the window either, but believe me, I'm going to be jumping out if there's a fire in there. And I remember my brother one time, you know, it's like if you put your hand in a light socket and there's electricity on, you're going to do something. You're either going to shout, fly, dance, or do something. And not everybody acts the same way when the Holy Ghost comes on them, but there's a difference. I remember one time my little brother got this bright idea. He was going to stick a bobby pin in the light socket. And I didn't discourage it because I was wondering what it was going to do. And he took this bobby pin. He said, "You think I should do it?" I said, "I don't know, but that's up to you." So he took the bobby pin. It wasn't a socket. It was down into a lamp where a light bulb should be screwed, and there wasn't a light bulb in there. He stuck out in there. Man, I'm telling you what, he flew backwards, and there was a mark of the whole end of the bobby pin in his finger for a very long time. But I want to tell you something. He didn't say, "Wow, I'm just not emotional." No, trust me, he showed emotion. And I'm telling you tonight, when the Holy Ghost gets a hold of you in a good old way, you're going to get emotional. Hallelujah. Do not let the devil, the thief of your soul, steal your joy. Keep your home security system on. How are you going to do that? One, don't resist the Holy Ghost. There's a reason why the Holy Ghost moves on us the way he does. Oh, man, people used to talk about us crazy holy rollers rolling around on the floor and swinging from the chandeliers. And I'm telling you what, I've been Pentecost since I've been 13, and I ain't never seen anybody swing from a chandelier. But if there's a chandelier in a church and the Holy Ghost wants me to do it, I'm open. But I ain't never seen it. But don't resist the Holy Ghost. There is a reason. Let yourself be open to him. I'm telling you what, I can give you examples. There was one time I was in a church, and I was kind of down the Molly Grubs, and that doesn't happen very often, but sometimes it does. And I was standing at the altar, and the minister came up, gave me a little zap of the Holy Ghost, and I stood there, and it was just like I was running in place for about 15 minutes. And afterwards, my son said, "Mom," he said, "you look kind of funny standing up here. It looked like you were running in place." I said, "That's all right, because God sure did fill me with joy, and that's all that matters." There's been times when I have run around the church. Why do you think God enables and allows us to do that? There's different reasons. There was a time when, one time at an altar service, I just laughed and laughed and laughed and laughed. Pastor Judy Rose's church. Probably for about an hour. It brought joy. It brought excitement into my life. There's a reason why. I've danced in the spirit all over the church before. And sometimes it's because, you know, God wants to keep us humble. And some of us, I'm telling you, we just got a little bit too much pride. Well, God, I love to see Sister So-and-so laugh. God, why don't you touch Sister So-and-so tonight? I really want to see her jump. God, this place is kind of dead. I want to see you move tonight. But oh, don't move on me. Move on Brother So-and-so. Touch Sister Barb here and let her do her little Holy Ghost dance. I love it. But you know what?
I love it when God speaks and touches me. Do not allow the thief of your soul to rob you and steal from you your joy. You can do that. You can activate the home security system by not resisting the power of the Holy Ghost. Number two, don't go by your feelings. That's where we get ourselves into trouble. Some people you can read from the time they come through a church door that they had a fight with their husband or wife before they got there, or something bad's going on. It happens, but let it in the car. Come in and pray about it and raise your hands and begin to shout. Don't resist the Holy Ghost. Don't go by feelings. Why do you think we talk about the sacrifice of praise? I'm going to tell you something. Most times when you feel the least like praising is when you better be praising God the most. I tell you what, I saw praise and worship. Mighty things happen in praise and worship. One night I was up singing a song and the power of God hit, and there was a lady in the back of the church stood to her feet and gave out a Holy Ghost yell, telling you what, make the hair stand up in the back of your head. She was delivered from congested sinuses that she had had for weeks. But through the power of the Holy Ghost, when people were worshiping, she was healed of that infection. There's a reason why we wait on God. We get in too much of a hurry and we show our feelings and ride them on our shoulders. I'm going to tell you something. When you walk through that door, you might not be in a desperate situation. You might not be at a time in your life right then and there that if God doesn't move and do a miracle, you're just not going to make it. But maybe the one sitting in front of you or behind you or beside you or around you may be. And I never want to be accused of being a hindrance of God working or moving through somebody. Do not resist the Holy Ghost. Do not go by your feelings. And the last point. Very important. Do not become satisfied. Right. Amen. A lot of satisfied people sitting in churches. Right. Well, I guess I got to get up again and go to church. I'd much rather sit here and watch Jimmy Swagger, but they'll be wondering where I'm at. I guess I'll go because after church, I'll make it through it because after church there's a big buffet I'm going to, so I guess I can tolerate it until then. Wrong attitude. Wrong attitude. Don't ever become satisfied. Do you know what? This might come as a big shock to you, but a lot of times the pastor is not the main key to the service. It might be you. God might be wanting to use you. God might be wanting to use you to encourage your brother and sister. He might give you a word to tell somebody, just a handshake or a smile or a word of encouragement. You don't know what God's going to use you to do. But you have to be open to him. And you can't sit there on the pew like a bump on a log and be satisfied and say, let me just get through this service. That's wrong. Don't become satisfied. Desire more and more and more of him. Do not allow the thief to steal you of your joy and your excitement. You know, it's exciting to be a Christian. I don't understand why people think that we're missing out on so much and why they think it's boring. Maybe it is if you resist the Holy Ghost and just sit there and can't wait to get out to go to the buffet. But if you're serious about the things of God, and you're there saying, God, remember, I'm a tool. I'm an instrument in your hands, Lord. Remember, do you want to use me? Let me be open, Lord. Is my ears open to you? Are my eyes open to what you want to show me? It's exciting because you never know what God's going to do in a service. Do not allow the devil to steal you, the thief of your soul, to steal your joy and your excitement. Amen. So let's sum up. God has given us the best home security system that we could ever have. The enemy of our soul, the great thief. Yes, he did come to steal from us and to kill and destroy us. But he has given us a security system. He has given us a way to not allow the thief to steal from us. He has given us a way that we will not lose our desperation for him. We will make up our mind that our home security system will start when the devil or the thief of our soul tries to steal our faith. And when the devil, the thief of your soul, comes along and tries to steal you of your joy and excitement, you just pray all the harder that the Holy Ghost will move on you and he will accomplish what he desires to do in you, and you will be an example of the way that the Holy Ghost can move on a person. Amen. Amen. Everyone standing. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother, could I pray for you, please? Could I pray for you? I come back here. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Lord, I pray for my brother tonight, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brother, the Lord was showing me that there is a desire that he is raising up in your spirit. I'm reminded of the Bible verse that says, as the heart panteth after the waters, so my soul longeth for thee. And I believe that the Lord is beginning to stir up a desire, a hunger and a thirst for righteousness. There's been some time now that you have not been satisfied. You have wanted to go deeper, and you have wanted more and more and more and more, just like I was talking about tonight. And God wants to tell you tonight that he sees that desire. And he tells you tonight that those who hunger and thirst after righteousness